Red Frogs, we partner with a whole bunch of organizations and try to keep kids safe during the matric rage season. Red Frogs brings a lot of memories back for me because Jess and I have been part of Red Frogs since its inception, way back in like 2009, somewhere around there, and really is a great initiative. But hello, why don't you turn to someone and give them a high five or a Bluetooth high five if you don't want to actually touch them. That's fine too. There we go. This season, I'm excited to share with you this morning, and this season particularly for Jess and I is kind of an important season. It's been a season of reflection because this month, October 2022, marks 15 years of full-time ministry on staff here at Grace for Jess and I. So yeah, you can clap. Thank you. We made it. We survived. I mean, look at that photo. That's our first Alpha in 2008. On staff, we were baptizing people down the coast. Look at these two young, passionate, and completely clueless individuals. The next photo is a photo of me. You may not know, this is our first Global Leadership Summit. We just recently did it last week, our 17th summit. This was my first one on staff, 2007. You may not know this, but I didn't start as a pastor here at Grace. I started as the video guy. So I was the video, I think because I had a Mac computer that like qualified me to be the video department, basically. But it's been an incredible many years. And I mean, I remember my first time walking into Grace Family Church. It wasn't in this building. It was in the Northlands High School school hall way back in the day in 2004. Before we joined staff, I remember I'd given my life to God in 2003 in my last year of university down in Cape Town. And then I'd moved back to KZN to do my community service as a physiotherapist. And I remember visiting Grace Family Church for the very first time, walking into that school hall. And I mean, we didn't have, you know, lights and haze and, you know, we didn't have any of this stuff. We just had an overhead projector. You remember that? Some of you are looking at me like you don't even know what an overhead projector is. It was a thing where you had to put the slides on, and the guy was always late with putting the words on. Anyway. But of course, none of this stuff matters. You know, it's not about this stuff or even the building or where we meet. What matters is that when I stepped through the doors, Mandy Carter, who was part of our hospitality team, she embraced me. She threw her arms around me and she said, "Welcome." I mean, I never met her in my life, but I knew in that moment that truly this was a community of people. This was a place where I could come as I am. And we didn't even have the strap line "come as you are" back then, but that was the culture that had been created. And I knew that this was a place that I could feel at home. And I hope and I pray that we're still that kind of church, amen? That we're still a place that unchurched people can come, that people who are far from God can come, that we a place where people can come as they are, where we can belong before we believe and all of that stuff. And so basically for Jess and I, or Jess pretty much her whole life, but for me the past 18 years being part of this Grace community, and honestly, I'm so grateful. I'm so humbled by the people who've gone before. I mean, Mark and Christine were in the earlier services, and I wish they were here now, but so grateful for those who've pioneered and gone before. And as someone who gets to stand on this stage, who gets to be part of this community called Grace and play some part in what God is doing here. And maybe that's part of your story. Maybe you feel like, hey, Grace is my home. I've been around for a while. Maybe you're new. This is your first time, or you've been checking us out, wondering, could this be home? Let me just say, whoever you are and wherever you come from, whatever your background, I want to reiterate, welcome. I want to reiterate, come as you are. Because I'm absolutely convinced that when we do, God is going to meet us here. God is going to do something amazing in your life. And He's going to use you to do even more than you thought possible. Amen? Now, we're not in a series today. It's kind of a one-off message. We're going to start a new series next week. But today, I want to look at a passage found in Joshua chapter 4. It's an Old Testament passage, and you may or may not be familiar with the story. But essentially, the context is that the people of Israel had left Egypt, and they'd been wandering around this desert for 40 years. And now, under the leadership of Joshua, who took over from Moses, they've now crossed the Jordan River into the so-called Promised Land, this land that had been promised to the people, to Abraham, many generations before. And it's in this moment, the crossing of the Jordan River, that God does a miracle for His people once again. By stopping the flow of the river and allowing them to pass, all 40,000 of them, on dry ground. Just like He'd done before with Moses and the people as they were led out of slavery in Egypt across the Red Sea. Now, this is super interesting if you're kind of a Bible nerd. I did some research on this Jordan River and how wide it is. And it's actually quite interesting that this stopping of the flow of the river has actually happened again three times in recorded history. In 1267, in 1906, and again in 1927. The flow of the river was stopped one time by a bank that collapsed for about 10 hours. Another time, the river stopped flowing for 21 hours because of an earthquake. Now, I don't know what method God used for Joshua in this time, whether it was an earthquake or a collapsing bank or whether it was just a supernatural occurrence, but it doesn't really matter. What matters is that the point of the story is that God made a way where there seemed to be no way. I mean, that's what this is about. And the people crossed on dry ground and they entered into the promised land. But then God does something strange, or instructs the people to do something quite strange. And I want to read to you from Joshua 4, verse 1. It says, "When all the people had crossed the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, 'Now choose 12 men, one from each tribe. Tell them, take 12 stones from the very place where the priests are standing, in the middle,'" say in the middle, "'in the middle,'" we're going to get back to that, "'of the Jordan. Carry them out and pile them up at the place where you will camp tonight.'" So Joshua called together the 12 men he'd chosen, one from each of the tribes of Israel, and he told them, "Go into the middle of the Jordan in front of the ark of the Lord your God. Each of you must pick up one stone." Now that stone is actually better translated as boulder. I mean, this is a big stone. "And carry it out on your shoulder, 12 stones in all, one for each of the 12 tribes of Israel." Why is he saying this? He says, "We will use these stones to build a memorial. And in the future, your children will ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' And then you can tell them, 'They remind us that the Jordan River stopped flowing when the Ark of the Lord's Covenant went across. These stones will stand as a memorial among the people of Israel forever.'" Now, what is this story all about? Let me pause there a little bit, because what I realize is that in every country and every culture in the world, there you will find memorials of various kinds. Now, it could be a majestic palace. It could be a statue. It could be just a simple plaque on a wall. But memorials are designed to remind present and future generations of people and events that have played a significant role in the shaping of history. I mean, I remember being so moved standing at the feet of the statue of Martin Luther King Jr. in Birmingham, Alabama at the Civil Rights Museum. I mean, just an incredible place. Like, you can, it's like a tangible sort of place. And then I remember seeing the Statue of Liberty for the first time in New York. I think of the Nelson Mandela capture site and the Apartheid Museum, just a place just up the road from us, an incredible place to go and visit and see. All reminders of people and events that shaped the world and our history as a nation and as a culture. But why are memorials necessary? Well, I think they are, and I think the reason they are is because we as human beings need reminders. I mean, we set reminders on our phone, we stick reminders on our fridges. We need visual aids sometimes to help us to remember. Because let's be honest, we're prone to forget. I mean, how many of you just, you don't have to raise your hand or anything, but how many of you, you just forget stuff on the regular? You can be honest, okay? Don't nudge the other person for them to be honest. I feel like it's getting worse. I feel like I've crossed over now. I'm in my 40s. It's getting worse. But let me just say this, I'm not as bad as my wife. I mean, I don't want to throw her under the bus, but I'm going to. She's preaching at Cornubia now, so it's fine. Don't tell her. We know she's a better preacher. Anyway, but I mean, Jess, like, she just forgets stuff all the time. She loses her keys like 14 times a day, like on average, okay? And what I've realized with Jess is the way her brain works is that if she puts something down on a countertop, that thing is gone. I mean, it no longer exists in time and space for her, okay? She just, it just, it's not there. But then at the same breath, we'll be like sitting and she'll be like, "Hey, remember that time we were sitting on the beach in 2002 and you said to me, da, 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 da," and I said, and I'm thinking, "What? How do you remember that? That's insane." I think she's just making it up. Anyway, Deuteronomy 8 verse 11 says, "Be careful not to forget the Lord your God." Now, why would God say it that way? Why didn't he just say, "Remember the Lord your God"? Why does he say, "Be careful not to forget"? I think it's because God knows that we actually have to be careful not to forget. Careful. That forgetting for us is so easy. And so when I look at the story of Joshua, it would seem that while the miracle took place in the river, getting through the river was not the end of it all. And God wanted his people to remember what had happened there that day for future generations and for those people. You see, sometimes I think the enemy of our faith is not doubt, but the enemy of our faith is forgetfulness. We forget about the goodness of God. We forget about the faithfulness of God. We forget about the people around us. I mean, this is just like in marriage. What I've found is that, yes, infidelity and, you know, unfaithfulness, these things are enemies of our relationships, and they can blow relationships up. But there are other enemies, like the enemy, the slow process of forgetting and the gradual failure to remember the preciousness of the other, the dignity of those we get to share our lives with. Man, when God dropped that in my spirit this week, I was convicted, because 17 years into marriage, it's easy to forget. Amen? You went a little too loudly. And if that's you today, maybe you just give your spouse's hand a little squeeze. Not like in an aggressive, like, are you listening way. Just like in a, hey, I get it. I mean, it's like the number one comment after, you know, sermons. People come to me and say, I wish my husband was here. He just really needed to hear this message. And I'm thinking, I think this message is for you. But just squeeze that person's hand as a way of saying, you know what, I want to choose to remember. I want to choose to remember why I love you. I want to choose to remember what attracted me to you in the first place. I will be careful not to forget. Because it's easy to forget in relationships, in friendships, in our finances. You know, we're so caught up in, God, this is what I need, and it's desperate, and please come through for me. We forget how he's been faithful to us in the past. We forget of the struggles that he's already helped us to overcome. Let us be careful not to forget. Amen? Memorials stand as signposts for us to remember. And they do three things. They encourage the present generation, that's us. They educate the next. And they stand as evidence for a watching world. Remember what God said to the people, to Joshua. He says, in the future, your children will ask, what do these stones mean? And then you can tell them. They remind us that the Jordan River stopped flowing when the ark of the Lord's covenant went across. In other words, they remind us that God is a way maker. He is a miracle worker. They remind us of how strong his rescuing hand is, that no matter what situation you're in, no matter how deep or how wide that river looks before you or behind you, our God is a God who rescues us from slavery and leads us out of the wilderness into his promises. I mean, you can just kind of imagine the scene. 20 years later, an Israelite son walking through the forest with his father. And they come across this massive pile of 12 stones, perhaps by now covered in moss. Many years have passed. And the son might say to the dad, hey, dad, what do these stones mean? What do they represent? And the father has an opportunity to say, son, let me tell you what happened here. Let me tell you about our God and the goodness of our God. Because this happened before you were born. You may not even know this, but son, we haven't always been farmers in this land. In fact, God gave us this land. We were slaves in Egypt once, but God rescued us by the power of his mighty hand. And then he instructed us to honor him and remember him in all that we do. That's what these stones mean. And this pattern of remembrance, it carries over into our lives and into the church today. Now, of course, we possess those promises spiritually in Christ, but for Joshua, he was being led into physical promised land. But of course, the principle of faith still applies. And here's the reality. When it comes to our faith, when it comes to the Christian life, here's the truth. We are always only one generation away from extinction. Isn't that crazy? One generation. Unless we pass on our faith to our children, and I'm not just talking to parents. I'm talking about passing on our faith to those that we have influence over us, the colleagues that we work with, the friends that we hang around with. Unless we pass that on, I'm telling you, we're one generation away from extinction. And I'm not just talking about telling people about Jesus, you know, get the bullhorn out, you know, stand on the street corner. I'm not talking about bashing people on the head with Bibles or giving them some body of information, some set of doctrines that they have to believe in order to get right with God. Christianity is not a propositional truth. This is not about sending our kids to kids' church, although that's a great thing, or you know, going to church once a week. I'm talking about helping the people around us to see in our lives a real and a living and authentic faith lived out day to day. Not a perfect faith, not a I have all the answers faith, not a, you know, but a real, living, and authentic faith, relationship with Jesus Christ, with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A faith that's more than just grace at the table. Does this make sense? Honestly, guys, I've said this many times before. This is my greatest desire. I don't want to build this big church if my kids don't know Jesus. Then to me, I feel like I've failed because many other people can do my job, but only one person can be a dad to my kids and husband to my wife. I want my boys to see my faith lived out day to day. I want them to see when I serve. I want them to see when I pray. I want them to see when I wrestle with God or when I give generously to those in need or when I lay down my life for their mom. I want them to see me tithe to the local church because I believe in the local church. My oldest boy, Will, he's 11 now, and we went away for a few days with some friends of ours, and they've got an older boy who's 13, and they were both playing on their iPads, and they were like, I could see Will was like comparing notes, and I wasn't in the room, they were in the room, and I just overheard, and Will looked over, and I could see, and he saw in Daniel's iPad that he downloaded a game that was 17 plus age. And it was so funny, I heard him say to Daniel, he said, "Geez, bro, are you even a Christian?" So Exodus chapter 13, verse 1 says, this will make sense in the end. The Lord said to Moses, "Dedicate to me every firstborn among the Israelites. The first offspring to be born of both humans and animals belongs to me." Now, let me pause there because this is a principle in the scriptures we see throughout the scriptures. It's called the principle of the first. It's this idea of giving our best and our first to God. It's a picture, if you will, of the tithe. And the tithe is more than just about finances, but God says, this belongs to me. But listen to what the next verse says. It says here, "And in the future, you'll recognize this, your children will ask you, what does all this mean?" You recognize that? "And then you will tell them, with the power of his mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, the place of slavery." What does this all mean? God is saying at some point in your life, your kids or the people around you are going to say, "Hey, why do you do this? You know, why do you serve for your church? Why do you give to the church? I mean, Dad, you work for the church. Isn't that enough? Why do you now give on top of that?" And you know what? I'll have an opportunity to say, "Hey, Will, hey, Luke, come here, boys. Let me tell you something. Dad hasn't always been a Christian. In fact, before I met your mom, I was a selfish person, very selfish, in fact. And I did some stuff and I made some decisions that actually caused damage to relationships and to myself. But you know what? God rescued me. God saved me. God poured out his grace upon me and forgave me. And to be honest, I'm pretty sure your mom and I wouldn't still be together if it wasn't for the grace and the mercy and the love and the forgiveness of God. That's just the truth. He's done so much for us. He's blessed us so much. And that, my boys, is why I give. Freely I have received, and so freely I give. Not under obligation, but as a joy. And I pray, my sons, that you too will know God's provision and experience his unfailing and unconditional love in your lives. I pray that. And please, this is not a message on tithing. This is a message on remembering. On remembering the goodness of God in our lives and sharing that with those around us. Not so much with words. Yes, with words. But more so with our lives. With our actions. Amen? So that's kind of the main message today. If you get nothing else, just get this. Be careful not to forget. Why don't you turn to someone and say, "Be careful not to forget." Be careful not to forget. Because Sometimes looking back helps us to move forward, right? Be careful not to forget the faithfulness of God. Be careful not to forget the times he got you through. Be careful not to forget the obstacles he helped you overcome. I mean, let's be honest. If people knew what you'd been through, if anyone knew the struggles you'd face, the things that you've overcome, they would say, like I say, "Man, it's a miracle that I'm here." I mean, it's a miracle that I'm standing here today. And it's the same for you, because you could have said, you could have quit. You could have said, "Hey, you know what?" You could have let those people, what they said about you, get to you, what happened to you, or what happened with your business, or that guy that ran off, or whatever. You could have turned around, you could have given up, but here you stand on the other side of a raging river, poised to step forth into the promises of God. You made it. Turn to someone and say, "I made it. I made it. It wasn't easy." It wasn't easy. I picked up a few scars and wounds along the way. There were times where it was tough. And I thought I wasn't going to make it. I'm watching Lord of the Rings with my boys now. Man, Frodo, Samwise, what legends. But I don't know. They didn't think they were going to make it. I should have just flown those birds all the way to the mountain, dropped the ring in. Anyway, but it would only been one movie, not 14 or whatever it is. But man, honestly, and this couldn't be more true of my life today, this idea that God, that it's, I'm here by the grace of God. I mean, I look at my life, we look at our lives. Jess and I have been reflecting this month on the last 15 years. And when we look back on the opportunities we've had, the places we've got to visit, the people we've got to meet, and I'm not just talking about the blessings of God in terms of financial, I'm talking about health and relationships and provision and opportunity. I mean, I'm and not just for like day-to-day stuff, not just for getting by, but for extravagant stuff. Over and over again. I mean, in 2 weeks' time, I'm going to Everest. I mean, it was so beyond my scope that I thought it would never be possible, and yet somehow God made it possible for me to get there. And I hope I come back alive. You know what I mean? Pray for me. But honestly, we have experienced over and over again. And let me say that it's not because I've been well-behaved or good or performed well or whatever, like good boy, well done Tom, this is a prize. No, that's not how God works. It's simply because of the goodness of who He is. He's a good, good Father. That's who He is, and we're loved by Him. That's who we are. Why would He not want to give us an abundance of life? That's what He paid a price for on the cross. I mean, think about the people of Israel. It's not like God said, okay, now you've been well-behaved, so now you can cross. No, no, those folks, I mean, they worshipped other gods. They were murdering each other. They were turning their backs on God. I mean, they were not well-behaved, but God still made the river dry and allowed them to cross. I think of Grace Family Church, the past 30 years. 30 years, guys. Sometimes, you know, I mean it's incredible. And it was so great having Mark and Christine in the earlier service, because today, the 23rd of October, actually marks Mark von Straten, our founding pastor's birthday. I don't know how old he is, but I won't say 49. No, it's a bit older. And honestly, I'm so grateful for him and Christine for leaving the church, for coming down to Durban on the sense of call from God. And here we stand 30 years later in these amazing buildings. And I mean, I remember when two guys got together and paid for this land that we're on. Two people. It was incredible. I mean, no one could believe it. I remember that. Now we come in here and we're like, why is the aircon? And these lights are flickering, and it's just, I had to wait for the coffee, and my goodness. You know, and we forget that literally blood, sweat, and tears is in the foundations of the, I remember when we met on the ground before this building was built, a small church, we were 300-400 people. I remember hammering stakes into the ground to mark out the dimensions of this place, and we wrote prayers on those stakes. And those stakes, many of them are still embedded in the concourse, in the concrete. You can see them. The prayers have washed off because Oak used the wrong varnish, but anyway. I remember writing names of people that I would want to see come to faith under this carpet. I remember writing my dad's name on that back left, right there by that pillar. And honestly, when I wrote his name, I was in tears, because honestly, for me, that felt like the Jordan in full flood. Like, there is just no ways, God, that my dad would ever come to faith. No ways. Impossible. And yet God made it possible. And many years after that, my dad did come to faith. What I'm trying to say to you is that God is faithful and can be trusted, and His word is true, and His promises are sure. Amen? And His children, as His children, we would do well to remember that. We would do well. We would be well to be careful not to forget, because sometimes looking back helps us to move forward. I'm not talking about living in the past. I'm talking about reflecting on the past to help us move forward. And before I want to get a little more practical at the end today. I want to give you some questions to consider. But before we do that, I just want to say this, add this little caveat here, is that sometimes when I talk about remembering, it's not just about remembering the highlights, remembering the good times. Sometimes it's also about remembering the not so good times, because I think that's also really helpful. I listened to a podcast recently by a guy named Daniel Pink. He's one of my favorite authors. He just recently wrote a book called The Power of Regret, How Looking Backward Moves Us Forward. And he speaks about this idea of reframing regret. And it's interesting because he actually says that regret is one of the most universal emotions that human beings experience. In fact, one of the most common negative emotions that we experience. But the problem is, for many of us, we don't like to admit that we have regrets. We think that to admit or have regrets, there must be something wrong, or we did something wrong, or somehow we're different. I mean, that's why people get no regrets tattoos. You've seen them? I mean, this is like one of the most common tattoos. No offense if you have a no regrets tattoo. It's pretty awkward if you get a no regrets tattoo, though. I mean, just do the spell check, please. I mean, there's one guy who actually got a no regrets tattoo and then years later regretted it and had it removed. So that's like the height of irony. But anyway, regret. I mean, we think that if we experience regret, that something's wrong with us, but that's just not true. Regret is one of the most normal emotions that we can have. The problem is we've never been taught what to do with regret. And I think this is particularly true of the younger generation, you know, millennials and Gen Zs, because we tend to think that, you know, something's wrong with me. I feel horrible. I must be doing something wrong. This is hard. It shouldn't be this hard. And then we look around and we see on social media, oh my goodness, everyone else is just nailing it. You know, I mean, my Instagram, these people are just, look at this family with their, you know, 2.5 kids feeding them salad on a white couch, you know. And your kids are just throwing, you know, flings at each other, you know, on the couch. Anyway, and then you think, what are we doing wrong? I must be flawed. And so because it feels bad, we try to ignore it. And then when that doesn't work, we end up wallowing in it. And it causes shame. And of course, that's just a lie. Because everyone is struggling and everyone has regrets. Yes, Dan Pink says the only people who don't have regrets are 5-year-olds, people with brain damage, and sociopaths. So I feel like 5 and under just covers the blanket. But what I'm saying, the reason I say all this is because according to research, regret can actually be helpful depending on what we do with it. You see, because regret is so common, and what regret shows us is it actually shows us what we value. It's like a warning light on the dashboard showing us something. I remember doing a speech for my friend. He lives in the States now, but for his 21st, and I was also 21, so I mean, what do I know? And I did this speech, and it was just, the whole speech was about ripping him off. And I remember I regretted that speech for years because I didn't honor him, and this guy actually deserved to be honored. And I can like wallow in that, or I can say, well, what do I learn from that? Well, what I learned is that actually it's important to honor people. Yes, you can joke with them, but honestly, we need to honor people. And that's now become a lesson for me that next time I get to do a speech somewhere, I'm going to honor someone. You see, we can wallow in regret, or we can learn from it and actually get better from it. Does this make sense? I mean, this regret can actually become a memorial. It's a signpost if we acknowledge it and face up to it and use it to help us to get better, to not make the same mistakes again. So let us be careful not to forget both the good and the bad. You see, God wanted to ensure that the coming generations after Joshua and the people understood the story of what he had done for the people. And he wanted to ensure that the future generations kept building on what God had given to them and not made the same mistakes their ancestors made in the desert. Okay, so what has that got to do with you and me? Well, I think it has a lot to do with us because maybe right now you're in a transition season. Maybe you're going through a change. Maybe there are shifts going on in your heart, in your life. Perhaps you're leaving a season behind you and walking into something new. Maybe there's change going on. I mean, look, change is inevitable in this life. And we've seen change in the last few years at an unprecedented level. But my encouragement to you is, no matter what season you're in, is build an altar. Make a milestone. Let the stone speak. Look back over the ground you covered and tell the story of what God has done in your life. Remembering that he is powerful and true and faithful. You know, so often we don't see it in ourselves. You know, it's like when you see like a friend who's got a kid and you haven't seen them in a year and you see them, you're like, wow, I can't believe how much he's grown. The parent doesn't notice it because they're with them every day. And sometimes we need to look back and see how far we've actually come. Perhaps as you look back, you think, well, I don't know where God has been in my life. Maybe you're here because you're searching for signs and stories that God is real. And my prayer is that you would find many in this place. Because to be honest, if you just look around, every single person in this room is in some way a signpost to the goodness of God. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. God has done something in our lives. Maybe you feel like you've just had an ordinary life and you think, well, God hasn't really been with me. But I promise you, if you would take the time this week just to stop and to pause and to reflect and to remember, I believe that you will look back on experiences or situations that took place and you will see the hand of God on your life and you will see how actually he was there all along and that the journey you were walking was upon holy ground. Maybe you're here and you're in the middle. You're in the middle of the storm. in the middle of the river. You're in the middle of the divorce, the middle of the whatever it is. And remember what God said to Joshua. He says, go into the middle of the Jordan. Go back into the waters that you just came out of, the ones that you've been waiting to cross for 40 years, and bring something out that will symbolize what I brought you through. I mean, isn't that a crazy instruction? God, we've been waiting 40 years to get across this river. Now you want us to go back. But the scriptures say they didn't understand, but they obeyed. And what I realized in this life is that God doesn't always require our understanding, just our obedience. In fact, sometimes, most of the time, I found obedience unlocks understanding, not the other way around. If you're waiting to understand everything before you step across the river, I think you're going to be waiting on that bank for a long, long time. That's what faith is. It doesn't take faith once you've crossed over to speak about how good God is. It takes faith to stand in the middle and believe God for a miracle. That's what faith is. So build an altar. I don't care what that looks like. Write in a journal. Go buy a journal. It's an incredible habit to build into your life. So, there's so much science proving how much it impacts our mental health. Light a candle somewhere in your home, a kind of a space you can be quiet and reflect. Put a scripture on your phone, lock screen. So every time you pick up that phone, you're reminded of some sort of scripture or encouragement from God. Hang something around your neck. Start a family tradition around the dinner table, you know, sharing, you know, something that you're grateful to God for, or highs and lows, or whatever it is. Get a tattoo. Just not a no regrets one. I don't care how you do it, but build some kind of way of remembering so you'll never forget what God has done for you. So you'll remember this truth, the truth that His faithfulness endures forever. Amen. That's my application. This is not really a sermon about information. I'm hoping it's a sermon that leads to action. Because sometimes I think in Christian circles, Christians are guilty of this, we can actually become so educated, we become educated beyond our level of obedience. And we just listen to more and more sermons in Greek and Latin and history and context, but we don't actually change anything in our lives. So this is not about that. This is about going home and actually building some kind of a way of remembering, a habit that will remind us of where we are and where we've been and God's hand upon our lives. Is that okay? And here's some questions. Maybe you want to take out your phone, take a photo of the screen or whatever. Write this down in your notes. This is like your homework for the week, to go home and to reflect on these questions that I think can help guide you to remember, to be careful not to forget. The first is, what do I need to remember? Are you taking photos? This is my good side here, guys. Okay, just wait. Okay. You must get the angle right. Otherwise, okay. What do I need to remember? What has God done or what is God doing in my life right now that is worth giving thanks for? Man, I'm so guilty of this. I just move on to the next thing, the next request. But I tell you what, no matter what you're experiencing right now, no matter how terrible your situation may be, I can promise you there is always something to be thankful for. And then on the other side, what regrets do you have? What regrets do I have? Name them. Name them. Face them. What lessons can you learn from those regrets? Because there are lessons built into that. And then what challenge lies before you, before me, that I'm trusting God for? Write those down. You see, the battle, guys, isn't done. You know that. For the Israelites, in order for them to take possession of the promised land, they still had many battles to fight and many miles to walk. The crossing of the Jordan River was in very many ways the beginning. God was not done with them. And I want to declare today over your life, God is not done with you. And He's not done with this church, and He's not done in this world. The verse that got this church started, that got Mark and Christine to feel the call of God to leave Impangeni and come and plant a church in Durban in 1992, is from Zechariah chapter 4. You've heard this before if you've been around Grace. It says this: "Then he said to me, 'This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. What are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you'll become a plain, and he'll bring forth the top stone with the shout, grace. Grace to it.'" The mountain for Mark and Christine was planting a church, starting again from scratch. And the word was grace, grace to it. Also, the word of the Lord came to me saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation. I'm so grateful for those who've laid an incredible foundation. And his hands will finish it. And then you'll know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you. What God has done in this place and in the hearts of so many who call Grace home is absolutely, it's nothing short of a miracle. And we have seen many stones being removed, stones of addiction, stones of marital breakdown, stones of people caught in captivity to lies and all this stuff. But here's the truth, there are still many mountains before us. There are still many mountains. There are thousands of people in this city who have not heard the shout of grace, grace to it, who still live under this idea that God is some, you know, grumpy old dude up there, and they live under the burden of legalism and religiosity. And they need to hear the shout of grace. And we will not stop until every person has heard the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Amen? I will not stop. We live in a nation that is divided. We're divided by race, by class, by history. We're suspicious of each other, fear pulling us apart. We live in a world with unprecedented uncertainty like never before. There are many mountains ahead of us, and they must fall. You see, the foundations of this house have been laid, but God is not finished yet. There's still work to be done. And this church certainly will not be built by power or strength. It's not built by Tom or by Wayne or by Mark, but by God's Spirit, by the Spirit of God. And then we will see the mountain being removed stone by stone with a shout, grace, grace to it. That we would be the kind of church, a church that unchurched people love to attend, a church where all people can come as they are and experience the life of Jesus Christ at work in their hearts, a church that joins God's mission to bring healing and hope to the world. Can I get an amen? Now we're going to close our service. I'm going to ask the band to come up, and we're just going to close by singing. And it's been quite an incredible morning, because we've also got people who are coming forward to be baptized this morning. And we had 23 people in the first two services baptized this morning. Just incredible. People just came out of nowhere. People came in their clothes. We heat the pool here, so that's how lonely we are. So just, okay, if you're worried about that. But I'm going to call the band up, and we're going to sing a song again, and we're going to baptize. And if you need to go, that's fine. But I'd encourage you to stay and to witness their confession of faith, because that's what this is about. And so as the band get ready, as we get ready to baptize, I just want to end with this chapter from Matthew chapter 16. It's where Jesus asked the disciples, hey disciples, who do you say I am? And the disciples, they're a bit confused. The one guy says, hey, you're Elijah reincarnated. No, you're John the Baptist. But then Peter stands up, and Peter says, no, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And that's when Jesus says, Peter, you're right. Peter means rock. And he says, upon this confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And he wasn't talking about Peter's name. Some people say, upon Peter, I'll build the church. No, upon this confession of faith, this confession that Jesus is Lord and Savior. That's what I'll build my church upon. Jesus Christ is the rock. Those going through the waters of baptism, we just ask them a simple question. Do you declare Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And they simply say, I do. And then we say, upon your confession of faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then the scriptures say, all of heaven rejoices when one comes back to the Father. And I'm telling you, this church and all churches around the world, they are built upon the confession of Jesus Christ, the faith of billions and billions of Christians around the world. And that is what we're going to declare. So I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to sing that song again. We're going to declare God is bigger than we thought. And I'm going to ask you to join with me. If you need to go, that's fine. You can leave. But we encourage you to kind of stand as witnesses and recommit your own baptism vows to declare Jesus is Lord and Savior. And upon those confessions, God will build his church. And many will come to know that there is a God who loves them and cares for them and has a plan and purpose for their lives. Let me say this. God is faithful and he can be trusted. His words are true and his promises are sure. On Christ, the solid rock, we stand. All else is sinking sand. Our Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are indeed so much bigger, so much greater than anything we could be going through, Lord. We thank you for these testimonies, these confessions of faith. We thank you for those going through the waters of baptism. Won't you protect them, guide them, be with them, show them your face, be a light unto their feet. Lord, we thank you. Help us to remember. Help us to be careful not to forget your goodness and your faithfulness. So we worship you, we thank you, we praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Have a great week. We'll see you next time. To do the same.